You may be seated. Well, happy new year to everybody. Amen. Praise God. Good to see everybody that made it. And we thank the Lord for a new year, new opportunities. Amen. This morning, I titled my message out of a passage from Revelation 21:5, just a small portion of that passage, and what it's the words that stick out to me say, "I make all things new." Yeah. It's talking about the new heavens and the new earth. You know, there was a movie that Mel Gibson made. I'm not really all about the movie. I did enjoy the movie. I don't want to say that I didn't enjoy it, but it had a lot of Catholicism mixed up in it. But the Passion of the Christ, there was one scene that was really kind of taken out of context, but to me it was so powerful. Jesus was carrying the cross down an alleyway, and he falls down with the cross, and he looks at his mom, and he says, "See, I make all things new." And when he said that, man, I'm telling you, it just touched my heart, because that's what Jesus came to do. Amen. He came to make all things new. I'm going to get Sandy to follow along with me. We're going to go through a lot of scripture this morning. I just want you to know, though, for you, for your heart, for your life, amen, for this new year, that Jesus has already made all things new. Amen. So let's look at 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 5, and then we're going to look at a passage out of 1 Peter. And if you have your Bibles, you can turn with us. In 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 5, it says, "And spared not the old world." Talking about God spared not the old world. That was the world that was before the flood. But he saved Noah, the eighth person, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood upon the world of the ungodly. And I want you to notice, it talked about the fact that Noah was the eighth person. I want you to focus on that for a little bit. But then we're going to go to 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 20 through 22. And it's talking about some of the fallen angels. It says, "Which sometime were disobedient." That's talking about some fallen angels and some boundaries that they crossed in the old world. It says, "Which sometime were disobedient, when once the longsuffering of God waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was a preparing, wherein few, that is eight souls, were saved by water." There's the word eight, or the number eight, utilized again. "The like figure, whereunto even baptism does also now save us, not the putting away of the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience towards God by the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is on the right hand of God, angels and authorities and powers being made subject unto him." In the first passage, it actually used the terminology. It says that God spared not the old world. It talked in both passages about the fact that Noah and his family were eight people. And in the second passage, it talks about the fact that the flood is like a baptism, in the sense that the flood separated the old world from the new world. And baptism separates the old life from the new life. Amen. The baptism that we undergo in the Christian faith is a symbolism of the passing away of the old man born of Adam and a new man gaining new life in Christ. Amen. And I want you to see that this is what the terminology that's being used. But Peter uses the number eight both times. And what I need you to understand is that the number eight in and of itself represents new beginnings. I'm going to explain that a little bit more to you, but I need you to understand that it goes all the way back to creation. Why does the number eight represent new beginnings? Well, God created man on the sixth day, and then on the seventh day, God rested. God rested not because he was tired, but because the work was finished. The work was a completed work. That's why in the New Testament, Jesus is our Sabbath, because we find our rest in him. He's the fulfillment of the Sabbath feast. Amen. We find the work of Christ is a completed work, just as the work of creation was a completed work. That's why when Jesus and Mr. Paul sang the song this morning, Jesus said, "It is finished." The work that Jesus came to do for the Father is a completed work. It's a finished work. But the number eight comes after the number seven, and it's a number of new beginnings. Noah and his family lived in what scholars would have called the old world, meaning that the world was filled with darkness and sin at a level where it's difficult for us to comprehend. And Peter even said it once again, that God spared not the old world. He destroyed the old world and he made things new. He started fresh. It's an American tradition every year, whenever New Year's rolls around, that we come with good intentions, right? I mean, we come with good intentions. We're going to start the year off right. We got, you know, they've trained us to think of these resolutions. I was listening to some guys in the gym the other day. Oh, yeah, wait, Wait till New Year's comes, dude. You're going to want to change your workout time because, you know, people are going to just flock the gym. It's going to be full, but it's only going to be for about a month or two. And then they'll all start falling off and we'll have the gym back to ourselves. I was just kind of listening to them talk. The reality of it is that to some extent that's true, even in churches. I mean, you know, a lot of times people want to start the new year off right and they'll have various resolutions, you know, whatever it is. I'm not going to eat sugar this year. I'm going to quit smoking or I'm going to quit drinking. This is my New Year's resolution. I'm just not going to do it anymore. And all those intentions are good, but the reality of it is that most of that, much of that, is built upon us trying in our own strength to accomplish the things that we're disappointed with in our lives. Yeah. We look backwards at the last year and we see, once again, regrets or failures or things that we didn't like the way things went. And we want to look forward to the next year and we want things to be better. Right? And there's nothing wrong with wanting things to be better. I remember they used to have when I first got saved over at Twin City, they'd have that New Year's Eve service late, that we'd have church late into the night, and people would talk, and they'd get up, and they'd share their testimonies, and I'll tell you, sometimes people get real transparent. They talk about the things that happened in the year past, and things that they didn't want to happen anymore, and old Sister Tim would bring out a shovel, and people would start digging a hole and saying, we're burying all that stuff from last year, but to be honest with you, even sometimes still, seemed like we were bearing the same thing year after year, you know? And so I think that the reality of it is that all of us would agree that, you know, there's things that are that from the last year that we don't like. But the reality I want you also to know is that God does start things fresh. God, I've said this many a times, He's not into rehab. He kills the old and He gives resurrection life to the new. Amen. And it's a finished work and it's a completed work. And that's one of the main things I wanted to say is that God does things different than the way that man does things. The reason number eight, I explained to you that God rested on the seventh day. And there's another concept about the number eight. And I'm not wanting to focus on the number eight as much as I am just about new beginnings is really what I'm trying to communicate with you this morning. But I wanted to use another passage out of Leviticus 23. Verses 34 through 36. I have to build on this concept a little bit, so just be patient with me. But I want to show you another time where I believe that the number 8 speaks of new beginnings. So the number 8 in the first passage, let me just make this clear, represented the family of Noah. There were 8 of them. There was only 8 people that passed over from the old to the new. Okay, and once again, the number 8 represents a new beginning. But in Leviticus 23 verses 34 through 36, it's speaking about a specific feast. As a matter of fact, in Leviticus, in this chapter, it speaks about all the 7 feasts that the children of Israel engaged in on an annual basis. And it was a form of worship. And really and truly, these feasts point to Jesus, point to the first time that He came. And I believe they also point to the second time when He will come again. And the Feast of Tabernacles is the one that we're focusing on. And I'm going to bring it to a passage in Revelation and show you why I believe that this is talking about new beginnings and with the number 8. It says, "Speak unto the children of Israel, saying the 15th day of the 7th month shall be the Feast of Tabernacles for 7 days unto the Lord. On the first day shall be a holy convocation. You shall do no servile work therein." What does that mean? That means it's a Sabbath. It means on that day, you're not going to do any work. It's a Sabbath. It's a day of rest. On the first day of this feast, it's going to be a Sabbath day. You're not going to do any work. All right? "And you shall do no servile work therein. 7 days you shall offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord." So you're not going to work on the first day. And each and every day after that, you're going to offer a burnt offering unto the Lord, a sacrificial offering, which we understand now, looking backwards, that all these types and shadows, all these sacrifices represented Jesus and the sacrifice that He would offer for us on the cross. It says, "On the 8th day, there shall be a holy convocation unto you. You shall offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord. It is a solemn assembly, and you shall do no servile work therein." So the feast was known as a 7-day feast, but it actually lasted 8 days. And the first day was a Sabbath day, and the 8th day was a Sabbath day. So why another Sabbath on the 8th day? Because I believe that this feast describes a new beginning of God again. Just as there was a new beginning where God brought us from the old world into the new world, I believe that this feast was a foreshadowing of a time that's going to come even in the future where there's going to be a new beginning. As a matter of fact, I don't just believe it, I'm about to prove it to you. And whenever we go to, let me explain it a little bit more. When we go to Revelation chapter 21, verses 1 through 3. As you're turning there, I want you to understand that whenever what they did in this Feast of Tabernacles, let me explain that to you a little bit. The Feast of Tabernacles, for this 7 days, yeah, they had to offer up an offering, but not only that, they had to go and make themselves an outdoor place to live. They had to go gather up branches and make themselves a lean-to, if you will, some form of an outdoor tent made out of branches. And they still do it today. They'll build it on top of their roofs. They'll build it on the side of their house. And for 7 days, they have to live in this outdoor tent, outdoor tabernacle, this temporary structure for 7 days to remind them. It reminds them of something. What it reminds them of is the fact that during the wilderness journey, God was their provider. It reminds them, too, that they were a pilgrim. See, Abraham was a pilgrim who is the founder of God used Abraham to create a nation. And the Bible teaches us that Abraham was a sojourner. In other words, this earth was not his home. Peter tells us, and you and I also, that we're pilgrims, that we're on a journey. And the temporary nature of this structure reminded the children of Israel that this place wasn't their home, amen, that there was another place that they had to look forward to, but that God was their provider during that time frame. And for you and I, we need to understand that the fulfillment of that, it comes in the time frame whenever God will literally rule and reign upon this earth and his presence will be with mankind. There's going to be an end to the journey is what I'm trying to tell you. There's going to be an end to this fallen earth. There's going to be a time when God goes from the old and he transitions to the new. Just as he did with the old world into this new world, if you'll say it that way, there's going to literally be a new world, a new heavens and a new earth. Well, look at Revelation 21 verses 1 through 3. It says it right here. I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, look at this, look at the word. The tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. What I need you to understand is this, is that the tabernacle, the Feast of Tabernacles, I don't have time to get into teaching all of the feasts, but essentially, the Feast of Unleavened Bread represented the sinlessness, the sinless nature of Jesus. The Feast of the Passover, Paul said he was our Passover lamb. He was sacrificed for us. The Feast of First Fruits was the first Sunday after the Passover. Jesus resurrected on the Feast of First Fruits. The day of Pentecost was 50 days after the Feast of First Fruits. The Holy Spirit descended in the upper room and the church was birthed on the day of Pentecost. And then there were three feasts in the month of Tishri, which started in the month of Tishri, which was 7 months later. And they start off with the Feast of Trumpets, which I believe is going to be the time frame connected to the rapture of the church. And then there was, if you will, the Day of Atonement, which was where the presence of God, where the high priest would enter into the presence of God. And then there's the Feast of Tabernacles. And what we see is that the fulfillment of the Feast of Tabernacles is that the literal presence of God is going to dwell with his creation upon the earth. God's presence with his creation upon the earth. Really what I'm just trying to explain to you this morning more than anything is that God creates things new. Amen. He does new things. He gives new beginnings. He transitions from the old into the new. And many times we as people, the people of God, we have good intentions, but we're trying to fix up and make better what we already have, things that are already fallen, things that are already in shambles. And what God's wanting to do is he's wanting to do a new work, amen, and a new thing. Now, I have to tell you that there's going to be a fulfillment. There's going to be a new heavens and a new earth. And there was an old world that God brought us into this new world. And then there's going to be a new heavens and a new earth. But in the meantime, God did something new already. And it's called the new covenant. If you go to Hebrews chapter 8, verses 7 through 10, I just want to read that passage of scripture to you. I love the book of Hebrews. I see we got a problem here. Irving's daughter is going to try to out-preach the preacher more than... Nah, I'm just messing with it. It's all good, man. It's a new year. Hebrews chapter 8, verses 7 through 10. For if that first covenant had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for the second. In other words, if the Old Testament covenant and all the Old Testament sacrifices, all the Old Testament feasts, all the old ways of doing things could have accomplished ultimately God's will for what he wanted to do, then there wouldn't have been a need for a second covenant. For finding fault with them. Now you notice that terminology right there. God found fault with them. What's he talking about? He's talking about the children of Israel. There wasn't really a problem with the old covenant. The problem is with man. Even Paul came to the realization that the law wasn't the problem. The problem was with Paul. He was the one that had a sinful nature. He was the one that had the inability to accomplish in his own strength what God desired of him. And that's why you and I needed a new covenant, because we needed one who was faultless. We needed one who would never fail. We needed the strength of God to be resident on the inside of us, to give us the power of God in order to accomplish what it is that he's desiring to do. So God found fault with them. He says, behold, the days come, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel, with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they continued not in my covenant, and I regarded them not, says the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws into their mind and write them in their hearts, and I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people. One of the biggest thoughts that the Bible communicates is how God is getting his presence closer and closer to his creation. I've explained that many times as we've preached. In other words, when Adam and Eve fell, ultimately what resulted was that they were expelled from the garden, which represented the place that they had communion with God. But from that time moving forward, God has been progressively bringing his presence closer and closer to his people. And one of the things that it says about the new covenant was that this is one example of that. That instead of his word being written on tablets of stone, his word was going to be written on the hearts of his people. This is actually a passage out of Jeremiah 31:31. And the question that should be asked, we should all be thinkers when we read the scripture. How in the world is God going to write his word on the inside of man's heart? Well, I got to tell you, the same spirit that wrote his word on the tablets of stone now lives on the inside of the people of God. Amen. Those that have chosen to believe. And in the new covenant, that's what God does. He writes his word on the inside of our hearts. And so really and truly, I think more than anything, I'm kind of wanting just to remind you of the new covenant this morning. And I would ask a question. How would you describe the new covenant? I got to tell you, I pose the question to you because once again, I want to try to make you think. And I can assure you that I've thought about this a lot. For many years now, the Lord has asked me to preach, and I got to be honest with you, for the longest time, I knew a whole lot of information, but I really don't feel like I knew very well how to communicate the things that the Lord had given to me. I'm not saying that I still have figured it out, but I sure do pray, and I ask God, please help me to communicate better the ideas of what you have in your word. And so the question that I would ask to you is, I'm not asking you to shout it out necessarily, but rhetorically, how would you describe the new covenant? How would you, if you were talking to someone, describe the new covenant to someone? And what I want to just share this passage of scripture with you right here, because I believe this says it all. Matthew chapter 26, verses 26 through 28. It says in this passage of scripture, it says, and as they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body. And he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of it, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. That word testament right there, I don't know why the translators chose to translate it as testament. The word in the Greek is diaphake. What's important about that is that anytime you look in the King James Bible and you see the word covenant in the New Testament, it's going to be the Greek word, diaphake. So essentially, this word, it really means covenant. So what Jesus is saying is that my body, this bread, is representative of my body, and that this cup is representative of the blood of the new covenant. And so what I need you to understand is that this isn't a new thought. This is the fulfillment of an old thought, of the original thought of God, that the new covenant was going to be Jesus Christ, his body, who he was, and Jesus Christ, his sacrifice on the cross. Let me explain that a little bit more. I've shared this with the church many times, but we have a couple of visitors. I want to make sure that we're understanding that we didn't just pull this up out of somewhere and, you know, we slept at a Holiday Inn Express last night and we just got this revelation from God. No, this revelation is from God, but it's written clearly in the scriptures. When we read in the Old Testament, even with the fall of man, we see immediately that God promises that there would be a seed. He tells the serpent that, right? He says, the seed of the woman is going to crush your head. And so from that point moving forward, God progressively increases our understanding through his word, through his people Israel, until finally that revelation rests upon Jesus on the banks of the Jordan River. What do you mean? He told the serpent it would be the seed of the woman, but he told Abraham it would be his seed. He didn't just tell Abraham it would be his seed, but through Jacob, he told Judah that it would come from Judah. And it wouldn't just be from Judah, but he said to David, when you fall asleep with your fathers, I will set up an eternal throne for your seed after you. So it wouldn't just be the seed of the woman, it wouldn't just be the seed of Abraham or just the seed of Jacob, but it would also be the seed of David. We're told that the seed would be born of a virgin by Isaiah chapter 7. And then we're told in John chapter 1 that the word, that in the beginning was the word, the Word was with God, the Word was God, but the Word became flesh. Jesus Christ, his body. They quoted an Old Testament psalm in the book of Hebrews and said, a body you have prepared for me. The incarnation of the Christ, the eternal Word that spoke the worlds into existence, became a man. He clothed himself with the frailty of human flesh. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14, because the children were partakers of flesh and blood, he partook of the same. He became us. He became our brother so that he might, as a faithful high priest, be able to experience the pain, the heartache, the sorrow, the weakness in the sense of a human body, not because he understood, he didn't know sin, but he experienced the frailties of humanity, the body of Christ. That was who he was. That was the seed that was promised way back in the garden. But it wasn't just the seed. He said it was the cup. See, it's not just Jesus, but it's also his sacrifice. This is the blood of the new covenant. Adam and Eve attempted to cover their nakedness, the revelation of their sin, with the works of their own hands, with fig leaves. But God said, no. It provides skins for you. I don't know if you ever thought about that before, but there's no reason for that animal to die. Amen. That animal didn't have anything to do with Adam and Eve's disobedience. It was an innocent bystander. How you think people think, oh, God, maybe God just was up there. I was talking to somebody about that the other day. Actually, I was talking to somebody at the service last night. I mean, what do you think God did? You thought he just had some skins up there and he started sowing some skins? No, an animal was killed. Innocent blood was shed. And Adam and Eve were covered with those skins, but it wasn't just going to be a sacrifice for the first couple. It ended up being a sacrifice for a family in the book of Exodus for the Passover. And it wasn't just going to be a sacrifice for a family, but according to the book of Leviticus, on the Day of Atonement, it was a sacrifice for a whole nation. Because the high priest would enter in beyond the veil once a year. He would sprinkle blood on the mercy seat, and the sins of the nation were covered for a whole year. But on the banks of the Jordan River, I like the way Leonard Ravenhill, he was a revivalist, he said this. He said, I'm quite certain that on that day, he spoke with an English accent, I'm not going to try to fake that for you. I'm quite certain that on that day, that whenever John the Baptist said on the banks of the Jordan River, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, it didn't only echo through the Jordan Valley, but it echoed through every cavern in hell, causing demonic spirits to shudder, amen, because that was the fulfillment and the manifestation of the plan of God, that he would not only be the seed, amen, but he would also be the sacrifice. And Jesus said this, this is my body, it will be broken for you. And this is the cup of the new covenant. It's his blood, it would be shed for you. I'm here to tell you that God has come to do
a new thing. Amen. He's already done a new thing, and he wants you and I to communicate what he's done to a lost and dying world out there so that they will know that if they really want change in their life, it doesn't mean that even tomorrow you're not going to make a mistake. I'm sorry. It doesn't mean that tomorrow you're not still going to be living on a fallen earth. But it does mean that you can hold on to Jesus. It does mean you can have the new birth take place on the inside of your life, and that the grace of God can move in you and strengthen you and empower you, and you can begin to see new life grow in you. Amen? And you can walk with the Lord. Hallelujah. And you can watch him do a work on the inside of your life. Now, I need you to know that in this new covenant, there's also a new birth. I'm telling you something that I know you already know, but let's just think this through. John chapter 3, verses 3 through 6. See, Nicodemus didn't understand this. Real simple thought, but he didn't understand it. Jesus even told him at one point in the dialogue, he says, "You be the teacher of Israel and do not know these things." In other words, you're the one, Nick. You're the one that has all the answers. They're looking to you and you don't even know what I'm trying to explain to you. He says right here, Jesus answered and said unto him, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Now, I got to tell you this. You know, I hate to say it, but I was talking to that young lady. And if you watch the video, you know, nobody knows who I'm talking about. And I hope you do watch the video, and I hope you understand. And I'm just trying to speak truth. That, you know, people don't understand that God is offering a new birth. And the reality of it is that you can't see it. That's what Jesus was talking about. I didn't understand that for the longest time, but that there are two kingdoms that coexist upon this earth. And some people just can't see it. Amen. They cannot see the reality of the spiritual realm that exists among us. Mm-hmm. And you can try to talk to them about spiritual things, but the Bible says that the natural mind cannot perceive the things of God because they're spiritually understood. And until a man or a woman is born again, they cannot understand, they can't see the kingdom of God. Amen. Nor will they be able to enter into it. Because the first birth of Adam, we were born like him. That's why we needed a second birth, a new birth, to be made new in Christ. And that's what Jesus said. "I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus says unto him, "How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit." Now, you know, some people might not agree with me on this, but I personally believe that that part of the passage where it talks about being born of water, that it's comparing it to being born of the flesh. You see what I'm talking about? "Except a man be born of water and the Spirit." And then in the next verse, "That which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit." So it's connecting flesh to water and spirit to spirit. Well, what does that mean? The water terminology is talking about the natural birth. You're made up of over 90% water. Plus, whenever you're in your mother's womb, you're in water and you come out in water. And so the water has to do with the natural birth versus the spiritual birth. What Jesus was talking about was that which is born of the flesh is flesh. The first time you're born of your father Adam. You must be born again. There must be a spiritual birth that takes place. That's why it was quoted in Hebrews, "A body you have prepared for me." This is how the new birth takes place. Jesus came and he bore the sins of humanity upon him. And when you and I hear the good news of the gospel and we believe it by faith, an internal transformation takes place, amen, where we become born again, where the old man from the old world that was born of Adam dies, and a new man born again in Christ is resurrected to newness of life, just like the flood waters washed away the old world, amen. The new birth in Christ washes away the old life that we were born of Adam in. A spiritual birth takes place where we become a new creation in the eyes of God. I want you to put 2 Corinthians 5:17 up there. You know, when I first got saved, this is one of the first verses of scripture that they told me. And you know, it really didn't hit me though. And now it's so powerful when I look at this passage of scripture. It says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. In your new birth in Christ, you need to understand that you have now become a new creation. Amen? The old has passed away. The new has come. This is a revelation that we need to get from God. Amen? And this isn't just a bunch of talk. This is a miraculous miracle, a miracle that takes place on the inside where the Holy Spirit does a transformation to us and changes us, and we become a new creation in Christ. The old desires begin to fade away.
Amen.
New desires, new delights,
yes.
New hunger, like the brother was singing this morning. Hunger for God. Hunger for His Word. Hunger for His presence. Amen. Though I might be empty, I come to you because I know that only He can satisfy a weary soul.
Yeah.
Only He can satisfy the thirsty.
Yeah.
Only He can satisfy the hungry. That's why He told the Samaritan woman, after she had tried all of her life to find fulfillment and happiness, He who, if you knew who spoke to you, He could give you living water. And she, and you know, and the whole world is out there thirsty. And they're looking for things like she was, through another relationship, through something else. Same old story, going through the same old process, instead of trying something new. Trying to grab a hold of Jesus, and trying to really let Jesus do the work on the inside of our hearts. You're a new creation in Christ. Now, according to Romans chapter 6, verses 3 through 6, this is how He does that. The way He does that, it says that, know you not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into His death. Therefore we are buried with Him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of His death, we shall be also in the likeness of His resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with Him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. I just want us to go back and just slowly, like, look at some of these words. It says right there that we were baptized into His death. Then it says we were buried with Him into death. That even as He was raised, we also should walk in newness of life. Then it says, if we've been planted together in the likeness of His death, we shall also be in the likeness of His resurrection. Our old man was crucified with Him. I want you to see the terminology that's connecting us to Jesus. The word baptism is used there, and many times people get caught up in thinking that this is specifically talking about water baptism, but I have to tell you that there's no water in the Greek language here. Water baptism symbolizes what happens spiritually right here. I know that I draw this little stick man for y'all all the time, but this is what this is talking about right here. The old man, born of Adam, born broken, born dead in his first birth, is born again in Christ. I want you to see the union. If you look at that terminology, in the likeness of His death, in the likeness of His resurrection, planted with Him in death. And it's talking about the unity. Scholars call this the fact that we have been placed in vital union with Him. In the mind of God, we have been made one with Him in His death and His burial. And even as He was resurrected, we too should walk in newness of life. It might be a hard thing for you to wrap your mind around because maybe you don't feel it. Like you might be saying, preacher, I don't feel a whole lot different than what I did yesterday or last year. But what I need you to know is this. What the Word of God says is that if you put your faith in Christ, you, in the mind of God, you become one with Him. Amen? One with Him in His death. One with Him in His burial. And one with Him in His resurrection. And how did that happen? Because of your faith. Because somebody told you the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. The good news of the new covenant. The good news that the old man born of Adam now can be born again. And the way that that happens is that he becomes one with Jesus at the cross. He becomes one with Jesus at the tomb. and he becomes one with Jesus in resurrection life. Yes, it's true that there's going to be a new day on the horizon. Yes, it's true there's going to be a new heavens and a new earth. But I'm here to tell you that today he's already done a new thing.
Amen.
It's called the new covenant. Amen. And it offers a new birth. And it offers a new life. And it offers to tell you that you are a new creation. Amen. And that by faith in him and continued faith in him, you have access to grace that strengthens you and empowers you. Is everything going to go the way that you want it to on this fallen earth? Absolutely not. Or sometimes there's going to be heartaches and sorrow. Absolutely. But the God that you serve in the new life that you have, accessing his presence, can strengthen you, encourage you, and get you through this journey. Amen. Right. Until the day when the new heavens and the new earth show up, and God will literally dwell with his people. Amen. And there will be no more sorrow. There will be no more crying. There will be no more pain on that day. He does away with the old and he brings the new. If you go to Genesis chapter 5 verse 3. We're talking just a little bit more about the old versus the new. It says that Adam lived 130 years and he begat a son in his own likeness after his image. And he called his name Seth. You know, the first time I saw that, it was like very profound for me. And the reason I say that is because, and you'll know what I'm talking about, if you've been in the church for any length of time, our minds have been trained just to listen to what everybody tells us. Listen to what the preacher tells you.
Yeah.
Listen to what you were, what the preacher, see, but a preacher told him something, and a preacher told him something, and a preacher told him something. And I'm not saying that everything that the preachers told him was wrong. But what I'm saying is sometimes we got to back up. We got to hold on, preacher. I believe you, maybe. But let me go back to the word and let me find out if you're telling me the truth. And, you know, I don't mean to be technical, but at the same time, I mean to be very technical. That all of this time, everybody's saying, you're created in the image and likeness of God. Well, hold on, time out. Slow down a second. Adam was created in the image and likeness of God. Let's tell the whole story.
Yeah.
Adam was created in the image and likeness of God. But then Adam fell. And he was changed internally. Something happened to where he received something called a sinful nature. And now, springing forth from the loins of Adam is all the rest of humanity except Jesus. Hallelujah. He came from another seed, another source. But every single human being that has walked the face of the earth has been born of Adam, save Christ. And they've been born in the image and likeness of their father Adam. Seth was born in the image and likeness of his father Adam. That's why man must be born again.
Yes.
He was born the first time like his father Adam, and he must be born again the second time like Christ. That's why Paul called Jesus the last Adam. Jesus came to make right what the first Adam made wrong. The new man is born again so he can become like Jesus. Amen. 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 4 says right here in 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 4, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these you might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. I wanted you to just focus on that divine nature part. Because see, in your new birth in Christ, you've now received or become a partaker of the divine nature. There's a spiritual change that has taken place. I know we've already discussed this already. You've a new creature. There's a new birth. But now you've also become connected to the divine nature. The same spirit that wrote the word of God on tablets of stone now lives on the inside of your heart. And now you're in union with God, and God lives in you, and you draw power and strength from him. Amen. There's a connection now between you and the presence of God that's now living on the inside of you. You're a partaker of the divine nature. That doesn't mean that the sinful nature has been completely eradicated. If anybody tells you that, they're not telling you the truth. That's going to happen one day, though. New heavens, new earth, completely glorified body, no more sin, amen, be able to worship the Lord the way He deserves to be worshipped, no more crazy thoughts sometimes whenever you're worshiping God, where in the world that come from, you know, that's not of the Lord, make you, the enemy wants to try to condemn you and make you feel so bad, when the reality, you're over here just trying to focus on Jesus, one day all that stuff's going to be wiped away, amen. Right now, you're a partaker of the divine nature. The Holy Spirit wants to strengthen and encourage you. In Romans, because you're a partaker of the divine nature, according to Romans 8:29, I want you to know that a lot of times scholars have argued over what this means. Because, you know, they talk about predestination, meaning that certain Christians, meaning that certain people were meant to be saved and certain people were meant to go to hell. I believe that it's the plan of God that was predestinated. In other words, in the mind of God, He knew it was going to be Jesus. Well, I mean, I can prove that from the scriptures. 1 Peter 1:18, that you were not redeemed with corruptible things such as silver or gold, but by the precious blood of a lamb which was foreordained before the foundation of the earth. God knew before He ever formed the earth, before He ever formed man out of that lump of clay, before He ever breathed life into man, that the same enemy that tried to usurp His authority in the ages past was going to inject His creation with His poison, and that it was going to cause a fall to the human creation, but that He already had a plan in effect. Plan of redemption. Plan of buying back through the shedding of precious blood. So it's the plan that was predestinated, but God foreknew. It says right here in Romans 8:29, for whom He did foreknow. That's talking about you and I. He foreknew who was going to get saved. He also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brethren. Jesus was the firstborn from the dead. Amen. We find new birth in Him. But because of our new birth and the fact that the presence of God lives in us, and now we're partakers of the divine nature, we can be conformed into the image of Jesus. That's what the word says. Being conformed into the image of His Son. What does it mean? In the new birth with the new creation, as the Holy Spirit is moving and operating in the midst of our lives, God is molding us.
Yes.
God is molding us by His Spirit. Amen. He's making us look more and more like Jesus. And supposed to be looking less and less like us. Lord, help us. Amen. The Word of God works. God works. The problem that we have is ourself and our flesh that gets in the way. In this new covenant, the new creation has a new way of doing new things. According to Ezekiel, and this goes back to our resolution. There's nothing wrong with realizing the mistakes of the past and looking forward to doing things new in the future. But we got to understand that if we're going to try to do it in our own strength, we're going to be disappointed again next year.
Yeah.
According to Ezekiel chapter 36, verses 25 through 27, God says, I will sprinkle clean water upon you. I'm not going to get into the ashes of the red heifer and the fact that there's blood in this water, but I will remind you of that. Because God cleanses everything through the shedding of blood. It's all going back to the cross. It's all going back to the redemption plan of God. There is no resurrection without Calvary. There is no new life without Jesus' sacrificial death. And the sprinkling of clean water represents the ashes of the red heifer. The ashes of the red heifer were the red heifer was burned with the blood in it. So the blood was contained in the ashes. But nevertheless, this is how He said He would be clean from all your filthiness, from all your idols. I will cleanse you. Look at this. A new heart will I give you. A new spirit will I put within you. He was talking about the new covenant. He says, and I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh. This is 600 years before Jesus would ever show up on the scene. God talks to His people Israel. And He says, I'm going to take away your stony heart. I'm going to give you a heart of flesh. I'm going to put My Spirit within you. And I'm going to cause you to walk in My statutes. And you will keep My judgments. And you will do them.
Yes.
What is the point? The point is that in the new covenant and the new birth with the new creation, there's a new spirit living on the inside of you. You become a partaker of the presence of God. The God put His Spirit in you. He gave you a new heart that can be conformed into the image of Christ. And God, by His presence and His Spirit, is working in you. He's the one that's doing the work. Yes. He's the one that's giving you the strength.
Yes.
He's the one that's putting strength in your feeble knees. He's the one that's straightening out your crooked foot. Come on, the Bible talks about in Hebrews that sometimes our foot's crooked. And it's causing us to walk and veer off the path. The Lord wants to straighten it out.
Yes.
And He wants to cause us to walk down the straight and narrow path. Amen. Walking towards Him. Walking towards His will. In the new covenant, He gave us a new heart, a new spirit. And He put His spirit on the inside
yes.
of us. Amen. I'm really closing with this next verse. Philippians chapter 2, verse 13. It says, "For it is God which works in you, both to will and to do
Amen.
Of His good pleasure." I don't know about you, but I need God to change my will.
Yes.
Amen.
You understand what I'm getting at?
Yeah.
You leave Matt alone. He got his own will. He's going in another direction. I wish I could tell you that I woke up one morning and I wanted to be a God chaser like that old boy wrote in that book. But the reality of it is that I needed God to draw me. I didn't wake up one morning and with an epiphany say, "Oh, God is great and Matt is bad." And no, I needed God to draw me and to prove to me that I wasn't right and make me hungry and to break me and to make me desire. And I still need Him to do it each and every day. I need God to continue to grab a hold of Matt's will and to break it down and to cause Him and to change the desires of my heart to where my hunger and my thirst would be to run after God, that He would change my will, and that He would also cause me to do according to His good pleasure. The point that I really wanted to make is that we can try to make all the resolutions that we want to, but the way true Christianity works is that we realize we're a new creation in Christ, that the presence of God is living in us, and that God will reveal to us those areas where we need His strength, and that because of the cross, we have access to the grace of God. And it's a matter of faith. It's a matter of faith and understanding. Lord, You paid the penalty for my sin. And now I've been restored into Your presence. And in the presence of God, there is freedom. In the presence of God, there is liberty. Amen.
Yeah.
It's not just, I used to think this, and I promise I'm not going to go on and on. I used to think this. You know, when my sister passed away, I didn't know. I'd been a Christian for 12 years. I didn't know a whole lot about the Lord. But I found some strength in worshiping the Lord. And I'd get up at about 4 o'clock in the morning, and I'd turn on this worship music. And I'm telling you right now, if you've never done that, I encourage you to do it. And all of a sudden, in my brokenness, as I cried out upon the Lord, it was like heaven opened up, and He ran. Actually, that was one of the songs I used to listen to. It was like the grace of God was raining. I was being saturated with the presence of God. But you know what happened was, because I didn't understand really what the Bible was teaching, before you know it, I started putting my faith in getting up early every morning and worshiping God. Instead of keeping my faith in Jesus Christ and what He did for me at the cross. I started thinking that if I don't get up at 4 o'clock in the morning and worship the Lord, I'm going to fail today. And I started putting my hope and my trust in that. Well, guess what? There's going to be a day when you're going to wake up and you're going to hit snooze too many times. There's going to be a day, like even this morning, that my phone was on vibrate. For some reason, my alarm doesn't work when my phone's on vibrate. And I picked up the phone and it's been my alarm's been going off for 39 minutes. Well, guess what? I didn't have time to get up and turn on the worship music this morning. But good news, good news. You're still in Christ because your faith is in the eternal Lamb of God. You're still in Christ and you still have access to the presence of God. And even though today might not have started off the way you would have wanted it to, God is still in control. God will still strengthen you. He will still encourage you. He will still empower you. Amen. And you got a new year ahead of us. Lord, I hope the Lord comes back in 2017.
Amen.
I don't know about you,
Amen.
But I'm ready. I'm ready for the Lord to come back. Until He comes back, though, we need to be about our Father's business.
Amen.
We need to be doing the work of the Lord. Amen. We need to be spreading the truth of the gospel to those that are hurting out there.